other churches that we went to that Elaine mentioned, and it wasn't Bethel, but another church, was in New York. We had to go in through the metal detectors to go into church. Now, I found that a bit disconcerting because you've got security guards there. They had security guards at Bethel too, I can tell you, but they were sort of behind the scenes. They weren't in your face, they were there. But as you had to walk through a metal detector to go to church, and I thought, what's going on? I know it's New York. But the world is a dangerous place. The world has changed. It's not changing, it has changed. And tonight, I'm not going to talk about these things, but I just want to pick up one common thread that we've picked up for all the places we've been and the people we've spoken to. There's one common thread, and this is it. And we know this, that Jesus is coming. So that's an interesting thing because, you know, we know that. But as we go through life, we can become afraid of what's happening. You know, when you go to a church, you expect there's going to be some freedom. There was freedom in worship in these places, but to get the metal detector over and walk through this screen and security guards, they're eyeing you off as you walk in. There were a lot of people there. We were third floor up, I think. It's a big, huge theatre. It's a very large place. But I can still say this, that God was there. But that little church where Andrew Reeves in Vancouver, only about 100 odd people, home. And as I said, I really would like this place to feature that. No, I'm not saying we put our sign up, home. But I want us to think of this as home. There's a coffee place that meets, is around the world, and you know what it is. It's not in Adelaide anymore, but it was for a while. But wherever you go, you get this coffee chain. And they call themselves the third place. You've probably heard about them. I don't want to advertise them, but the third place. Home is the first place. The second place is your workplace. The third place is to go and have a coffee at this coffee chain. That's what they talk about, the third place. I've been thinking a lot about this and praying about it while I've been away. And I learned about this many years ago. But you know, I think we need to call our church. I mean, our homes are important, and I'll talk about that directly. But our church needs to be a place where we call home. It needs to be a place where we feel safe. It needs to be a place where we feel secure because we are a child of God. It's really important. And before we went away, I talked about the importance of creating a culture of encouragement. You know, that's what family is about. We're a family. And I still want to encourage us to create and build upon this encouragement, encouraging one another, building each other up. It's so important. There are so many criticisms and negatives around the world that we need to have a culture of encouragement. The other thing I want to talk to you about, just briefly, is that when we have visitors, we need to welcome them. We were so blessed in being welcomed in these places. Not so much the bigger places, because there are probably more visitors than regulars. No one knew who was what. And I remember Elaine and I on our honeymoon, we went to a little church in Lakes Entrance, and it was full. Sunday evening service, and no one was talking to anyone. And so Elaine and I mingled amongst the people. I mean, it's nearly 45 years ago. But no, it was the most unfriendly congregation we had ever been in. And as we moved amongst the people, we made a discovery that there were two locals there. Well, one had actually driven 40 miles. Now there was one local there, and that was the organist, and the pastor or the minister had come 40 miles to preach at the service. The rest were all visitors. Every single one of them were visitors. I want this to be a welcoming place. You know, when you go home, you feel welcome, don't you? You feel at home. This needs to be a place where we feel at home. So I want to encourage you with those things, because it's great. I think Elaine, I sensed in her words earlier, certainly for me, coming home tonight, I'm excited. I feel at home. It's good to be home. Anyway, that's just my prelude to what I want to say tonight. You know, as we travel around, one of the things, it's good to go away, it's great to come home, as I said, but it actually is good to go away because you get a broader perspective of what's going on. We can be locked into our own little sphere, own little space, and not realise that there's a bigger world out there to get an idea of what's going on. But as I said, there's that one common thread that I picked up in all of these churches, including conversations we had with people. There's the hope of Jesus' return. When is it? Well, we don't know that. And I don't want to talk too much about that tonight. But it's soon. It's soon. Now, people through the centuries have been saying it's soon. So I want to put this into some sort of perspective. I think as we look at prophetic words through the scriptures, we see things unfolding at a great rate of knots. Scriptures are being fulfilled before our eyes like never before. There are things happening that have been actually spoken about in the Word of God. You know those scriptures, you know what's happening. See, one of the dangers that I want to point out to us tonight is this, and this is what I think is happening around the world at the moment. You remember the proverbial frog in the pan of hot water put over the stove, and the flame was turned up just slowly, and it was just warm water. And the water slowly became warmer and warmer. The frog didn't even take any notice, but eventually boiled to death. He became numb to what was happening. I did a bit of research about that. And there were some experiments on that back in the 1700s, I'm thinking. But whether it's true or not, it doesn't matter. You get the point of what I'm saying. There are things that are creeping up on us in our world that are quite disconcerting to me as a Christian. We've seen some of those things as we've travelled around. But I don't have to travel to see those things because they're here. That's the importance of having a home, a family that we belong to, that we can talk about these things and be up to date with what's going on. I've been getting a prayer sent to me each day from, I won't say where it comes from, but I think that's unfair, but it's very weak. A prayer that came through talked about what the Dalai Lama is talking about. And I thought, why would a church be sending that to me? It's concerning. And then it said, another one said, hug a tree.
A what?
Oh, hug a tree. And I think, what's going on here? We are being numbed to what's going on. We're in danger of losing sight of reality. I want to encourage you as the people of God in this place to not lose your faith, to take everything back to this Word of God. Always refer to the Word of God. If it's not in here, don't have it in here. It needs to come from the Word of God. There is stuff happening like never before, but it's starting to roll over. I was reading the other day about a group of scientists, the right page, I need to just read this. They gathered together in 1947, a group of scientists, and they produced a magazine called The Bulletin of the Atomic Scientists. Have you heard of them?
No.
Well, they began this, and they began something known as the Doomsday Clock. Now, you would have heard of that, I think. They started and established the Doomsday Clock. Do you know, in January of this year, they reset it to 2 minutes to midnight. That's based upon the potential for a nuclear war in the world. Although, you know, maybe President Trump is doing something about that at this meeting that may or may not happen in Singapore in the next few weeks. But, you know, there's this risk, this heaviness hanging over the world of imminent attacks. And I see Vladimir Putin has announced that Russia has developed these new nuclear missiles that can't be shot down by whatever the interceptions. So they've released these new nuclear missiles that can't be shot down, that will reach their target. Now, if I was someone just living out there, had no faith at all, you'd say, what's going on? I think in Australia we're pretty safe in some ways. You're not safe anywhere. The world is targeting people of faith. Just let me warn you that. You're a people of faith. We've read in, while we're away over in the United States, I read an article about something that's happening in Adelaide. I've spoken to someone about it. They said, we didn't hear about it here. where a minister has been chastised because he spoke against homosexual marriage. And he's been threatened, he's been named in Parliament and all that. So I don't know whether you've heard about that, but I read that in the United States. So whether it's true or not, I don't know. I can't verify it. I didn't get the article. But it's happening, but there's some strange things happening. I want to encourage you tonight. I don't want to talk about these things. That's not what I want to talk about. But I'm just painting the background. I want to encourage you with some words from the Epistle to Peter. I'm going to read tonight from Peter chapter 4, I think it is. Did I just get that right? There's my paper.
Which one?
Yeah, which one? That's right. Which Peter? Yeah, 1 Peter 4, 7 to 11. There we go. 1 Peter 4, 7 to 11. This is what it says. The end of the world is coming soon. Now, I want to say this. We've been hearing that for generations and generations and generations. The scripture says very clearly that a day is like a thousand years for the Lord. So we don't know when it is, but we can look at the signs. The signs are there, but I don't want to focus on that again, as I say. So the end of the world is coming soon. This is what Peter's really saying. Therefore, be earnest and disciplined in your prayers. Most important of all, continue to show deep love for each other, for love covers a multitude of sins. Cheerfully share your home with those who need a place, a meal, or a place to stay. God has given each of you a gift from his great variety of spiritual gifts. Use them well to serve one another. Do you have the gift of speaking? Then speak as though God himself was speaking through you. Do you have the gift of helping others? Do it with all your strength and energy that God supplies, that everything that you do will bring glory to God through Jesus Christ. All glory and power to him forever and ever. Amen. They are encouraging words to me. I don't know about that to you. They're encouraging words. In a world where hearts are being hardened, in a world where we hear so much going wrong, where the heat's been turned up and people are becoming numb, there are even people in this room, I dare say, who have been caught up in some of this stuff that I would say is numbness. We don't even realise what we're doing or saying at times. I've heard some language just recently, someone who's a great Christian person, and I stood there thinking, now, what's actually this person talking about? The language left a bit to be desired. We're just forgetting what we're talking about, what we're saying. Be careful with our language. I'm talking not just to you, but I'm talking to me as well here. What we say and how we say it is important. It really is. As I said, that this message is to me as much as it's to you. Let's look at this scripture. I just want to talk to you a couple of minutes about this. We won't go on for a long time. Be earnest and disciplined in your prayers. I think that goes without saying. You know, we're a church who have seen answers to prayers in the last year or two. We've seen the hand of God at work. We've seen him answering prayers, and we believe by faith that as we pray, he hears our prayers, and we're not telling him what to do, but we're just bringing our petitions to him, and he hears and he answers. We trust him by faith. As John Blacker would say, what's the good of a God who doesn't answer prayer? God does answer prayer. And I get a bit excited when I look around and see some of the people here and know the answers to prayer. So, bring your prayers to God. Be earnest and disciplined in your prayers. Now, earnest means being constant. Not just, now I lay me down to sleep, pray this, Lord, my soul to keep. No, not that. Lord, I love you. But I want to love you more. I can't do it on my own. I need you to help me love you. Lord, give me some right words to speak into this situation. Lord, lead me to someone today that I can have a divine appointment with. Lord, give me some wisdom to know how to handle this situation. Earnest prayers. Earnest prayers. Be disciplined in your prayers. I just don't feel like praying at the moment. Be disciplined. You know, when you don't feel like praying is the time you need to be praying. When you don't feel like praying, call someone and say, I'm struggling a bit here. Can you pray for me? Can you help me with prayer? And here's the next verse. This is an interesting one. Most important of all, continue to show deep love for each other, for love covers a multitude of sin. You know, family is special. Years ago, Elaine and I and our family went away with another family, and they were beautiful people, great to go away with. It was a great holiday. We travelled a fair way with them. But Elaine, in her wisdom, said this: our family is special. We got on very well with the people, no trouble at all, but our little unique family unit was really, really special. We got on really well as friends, but friends and family are different. You know what I'm talking about. There's something unique and special about family. I love this family here. This is a bigger family than a nuclear family, but the family of God is important. And the scripture says here that love covers a multitude of sins. Now, as our kids were growing up, they used to argue a bit. Unusual, no, but if someone had a go at one of the children, at our children, the others would stand up for them, for that person, that one who was under torment. Have you noticed that? Family stands up for each other. We won't take any funny business, because this is our home. This is where we belong. That should go for our church as well. It's important for us to love one another. Now, I don't say that we've all got it together, because we haven't. We're all at different levels in our faith journey. We don't all agree with each other theologically. We'll never do that, because God's revealed different little bits to me than he has to you. And it's when we get together and talk about these things that we discover who God really is. He's bigger than me. He's bigger than you. But when we come together as a family, Paul talks about this, the body. Again, it's not my message tonight. I'm just giving you a message to encourage you and to build you up with all that's going on in our world, to prepare you. Because I believe God is in the business of preparing us for what is to come. So, most importantly of all, continue to show deep love for one another. That's not just love, deep love. Got that? Yeah. Deep love. Yeah, yeah. Right. Bigger than that, right? Even bigger. It's deep love. No criticism. Just love. Just a passionate love for each other, because it covers a multitude of sins. Cheerfully share your home with those who need a meal or a place to stay. Now, not all of us are able to do that. That's fine. But there's a message here for us. Maybe you can ring someone and meet them out for a coffee. A word of encouragement. How are you going? Now, how are you really going? This is what it's about. This is what Scripture's saying here. This is what Peter's saying. Cheerfully share your home. Now, each of us, God has given each of us a gift from his great variety of spiritual gifts. And if you were around, I think about a couple of years ago, we did a spiritual gifts workshop. And many of us discovered some of our gifts, or maybe it was just reignited that we knew that we had them, but it was confirmed in that. And in a year or two's time, God willing, we'll look at it again and see how our gifts may have changed. But each of us have special gifts and abilities that the Holy Spirit has given us, not just for us, but for our family, for the body of Christ. It changes our home. It changes how we look at things. It changes who we are. We are blessed. Like Abram in Genesis 12:2, we are blessed to be a blessing. We are blessed to be a blessing. It says here, each of us have been given a gift from God's great variety of spiritual gifts. I happen to believe that all the gifts are present in our family. All the gifts that we need. Do you have the gift of speaking? Some of you may have. Now, I'm not just talking about standing up here speaking. It may be just speaking to someone that you notice is feeling a bit low. Someone who has a bit of a cloud hanging over them. They're just not feeling themselves. There are times, you know, Paul talks about this too. There are times, and I said before, if you can't pray, and I'm really referring to this section of Paul where he says, call others to pray for you. There are times when we can't pray. We might groan in the spirit. We may use another language, but, you know, there are times when we just can't pray. When we're overwhelmed by our circumstances. When you just can't pray. Your wit's end. If you get to that point, give someone a call and say, I need some prayer. That's the beauty of having a family around us, that we can ring or knock on their door and say, help. No one's going to look down at you and say, can't you pray on your own? No, we're called to pray for each other. That's what a family's about, to pray one for the other. And you know, it's the greatest privilege that we can ever have, I believe, to pray for people, to bring them before the throne of the living God. Wow. And you know, in Revelation, I can't tell you exactly where, but it's in Revelation, the scripture talks about the bowls of the incense of the prayers of the people of God who are before the throne. Now think about that. Your prayers are sitting before the throne of God. That's pretty awesome. That's pretty amazing that our God hears our prayers. Wow. Do you have the gift of speaking? Then speak as though God was speaking himself, was speaking through you. That might, as I said, it might be up here, but it might just be in conversation. It might be in a home group. It might be in the prayer group. It might be just sharing or talking with each other. Do you have the gift of helping others? I've seen some gifts being exercised around our church, around this building. I've seen some amazing gifts, how things have come together. It doesn't just happen, it takes people who are willing to be involved. The meals just don't happen each week. The dishes don't get done. It doesn't just happen. I've got to put it on the spot, but it's just great to have people around. And the other day when we came home, Kerry came to pick us up. Thank you, Kerry. And I was going to give him a ring and say, we've just arrived. I was just looking in my pocket. And I looked around, he might have called my name, I don't know. There's this cheerful face, standing there smiling. I tell you what, I felt at home. It was a great moment. It's one of those moments where we'll stick there for a long time. Now we can do little bits and pieces that make a difference. It makes a difference in people's lives. Knock on someone's door and say, hey, you know, I've just come to visit you. Come see how you're going. There are lots of little bits and pieces that we can do that make a difference to others' lives. Do it with all the strength and energy that God supplies. That's an interesting verse. Feel a bit flat sometimes? Pray for a bit more energy and strength. This is the crunch verse. Then everything you do will bring glory to God through Jesus Christ. Isn't that good news? The things that we don't do them to get credit for ourselves. Not about us, it's about Him. Now I could go on for a long time talking about this, that's not my intention tonight. I just want to encourage us as a people of God. I want to encourage us. I know that next week Mike Rayson will be here, and Rob's mentioned him, I think, to you as a group. So next week is going to be a really special week. I expect that we'll have visitors. And I expect that as we see people that we're not sure of, that we'll encourage them and welcome them. You know, one of the things about family is we welcome others because we love our home. We love our church family. But we love other people coming and sharing with us as well. So next week is a great opportunity to invite your friends along to be a part of the service, to hear Mike. I don't know him, but I get some glowing reports from him. Yeah, yeah. And he's in his 40s, you reckon? About that, maybe give or take. Might be plus tax, is it?
Plus tax.
Whatever. It promises, from what I hear, going to be a great evening. So what an opportunity for us to speak into the community. You know, I've mentioned it so many times, but I'm going to keep on mentioning it. One of the things that I believe this church is called to do is this. I know it's called this. We are to pray for our family, our church, and we are called to pray for the community in which we're planted. They are the two focuses of our prayers that we need to be praying regularly each day. For our church, our family, always pray for our family, our church, us, not the building, that's the building. Our church is us. So we need to pray for our family, and pray for the community that God has placed us in. Yeah, we're placed in a very unique position. God has blessed us in abundance. But remember, we are blessed to be a blessing. If we focus upon ourselves, if we become, as they say, navel gazers, we miss the point. We miss the point. What a great place to call home. What a great thing to have family. What a great opportunity to share with each other the highs and the lows of life. But may God continue to bless you in your journey. Will you join me in prayer? Let's pray. Father God, we thank you from the very depth of our being for who you are. But tonight again, we just thank you for Jesus. And as we pray in his name, Lord, we just ask that you would just remind us again, freshen up our minds, of the gifts that you've given to us and the reasons why you've given those gifts to us. And Lord, we pray tonight for energy, for substance, for the abilities to be able to use those gifts as gifts towards the kingdom of God in this place. We thank you for who you are, Lord, and we heard earlier in our message tonight about some of the sinister things that seem to be appearing around us, but Lord, we take heart that we've got no reason to be afraid because we're children of a living God. We're not slaves of fear. We're a child of God. And Lord, as we step back out into our world, we pray that this coming week would bring us joy because of the opportunities that you give us to speak into the lives of others, to point others to Jesus. Father God, we just give you thanks and praise in his name. And now may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the presence of his Holy Spirit go with us.